الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله بالهدى ودين الحق يرسله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن يتبع غير سبيل المؤمنين نوله ما تولى ونصله جهنم وساءت مصيرا قال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين او كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الامين الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين الله رب محمد صلى عليه وسلم அல்லாஹு ரப்பு முஹம்மதின் ஸல்லல்லாஹு அலைஹி வஸல்லமா நஹ்னு இபாது முஹம்மதின் ஸல்லல்லாஹு அலைஹி வஸல்லமா வஅலா தவீஹி வஸஹ்பிஹி அபதத் துஹூரி வகர்மா ரப்பி ஷ்ரஹ் லி ஸத்ரி வயஸ்ஸிர் லி அம்ரி வஹ்லுல் உக்தத்தம் மின் லிஸானி யஃப்கஹு கௌலி. ரெஸ்பெக்டட் சாதாத் ஐஸாம், உலமா கிராம், மை டியர் எல்டர்ஸ் அண்ட் பிரதர்ஸ், அல்ஹம்துலில்லாஹ் we are among those people who are following the aqaid of ahlus sunnati wal jamaa. May Allah tabaraka wa taala keep all of us firm on the aqida of ahlus sunnati wal jamaa. Sayyiduna imam tahtawi radiyallahu taala anhu has stated that today, in the sense not today, during his time, centuries ago, Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'a are those who are following one of the four madhab, such as Hanafi, Shafi'i, Maliki and Hanbali. He stated qad ijtama'atil nas like today, the Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'a, the group of Najia, has been divided, are following one of the four madhab of Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'a, humul Hanafiyun, dosa Hanafi, wal Malikiyun, Maliki, wal Shafi'iyun, Shafi'i, wal Hanbaliyun, and Hanbali. And further stated, وَمَنْ خَارِجَ عَنْ هَذِهِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ, the one who is deviated from these four madhab, فَهُوَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْبِدْعَةِ وَالنَّارِ, he is the person who is doing bid'ah, he is an innovator and he is a person of nar. Those people who call us as bid'ati, those people who call the followers of Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal as bid'atis, as innovators, Sayyiduna Imam Tahtawi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu has stated centuries ago that these people are the bid'atis who are against following the imams. So anyone who is against following any one of the four imam, faman min ahlil bid'ah, he is among the people of bid'ah, the innovators, one nar, and he is the person of jahannam. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, may he protect all of us from those bid'atis. My dear brothers, there can be a question, why do we need to follow any one of the four imam when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has mentioned everything in the Holy Quran? When Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has explained, he has understood the whole Quran. Allah ta'ala is the one who taught the Holy Quran to Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in such a way that no one has rights to say that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam is unaware of so and so thing, of such and such a thing. Allahu Akbar. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam has stated that you follow the Quran and my sunnah, you will be on the right path. Then what is the need of the following of any one of the four imam? These are the questions raised among the general public in order to make the general folks away from the real path of Islam, from the real jama'at of Islam, which is Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. My dear brothers, if the Holy Quran and the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was so easy to understand, then what was the necessity of writing the tafsir of the Holy Quran, and that too in Arabic language? When Quran has everything, then what was the necessity to write the tafsir of Quran? Why did Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote the tafsir of Quran? Why did Sayyiduna Imam Baydawi radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote the tafsir of Quran? What was the necessity for Imam Ibn Kasir to write the tafsir of Quran? Why Sayyiduna Imam Fakhruddin Razi radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote the tafsir of Quran? Leave all these a'imma, all these mufassirin aside. Why did Sahabi Rasul Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote the tafsir of Quran? This clearly shows that everyone is not able to understand the Holy Quran, and this is the reason the tafsir of Quran was written even by Sahaba Karam Ridwanullahi ta'ala alihi majma'in. Similarly, if hadith was so easy to understand, why did Fathul Bari by Imam Ibn Hajar, why did he wrote the tafsir of Sahih Bukhari? When it is so easy to understand, already translated in English, in Tamil, then what is the necessity for the tafsir, and that too in Arabic language? Why did Imam Nawawi radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote the tafsir of Sahih Muslim? What was the need of that? Allahu Akbar. This clearly shows Quran and Hadith has everything, but everyone is not able to understand the Quran and Hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only those people whom Allah ta'ala has blessed with such a knowledge, such a wisdom, and that too after wilayat, they have understood the Holy Quran in such a way that we are unable to understand, we are unable to comprehend their knowledge in the Holy Quran and their knowledge of hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam. My dear brothers, when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants to make a person his friend, a wali of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, instantly, even if Allah wants to make a person his friend, the way Allah Ta'ala makes him his friend, at the same time, first of all, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala gives him the knowledge and the wisdom. Because a jahil cannot be a wali of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. If Allah Ta'ala selects a person to become his wali, first of all, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala blesses him with such knowledge which is specially given to him. And after that knowledge, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala grants him that status of wilayat which is destined for him. Subhanallah. Anyway, my dear brothers, if Quran was so easy to understand, if the hadith were so easy to understand, what was the necessity to write the tafsir, and that too not in other languages but in Arabic itself? Whereas the hadith are in Arabic, Quran is in Arabic, but the tafsir, and that too in volumes, not one or two volumes. Some tafsir are filled with 30 volumes, some with 40 volumes, some tafsir with 80 volumes. And again, it's never ending. As stated in the Holy Quran, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has stated, وَلَوْ أَنَّ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٍ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبُحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. If you make use of all the trees of this earth as your pen, make use of all the trees and create pens, and make use of the ocean in order to make ink for you to use that ink with your pen and to write the tafsir of the Holy Quran. Allahu Akbar. My dear brothers, in a small pen, how much does the water contain?
just few drops of water, and by one pen you can write hundreds of pages. Subhanallah, just with one or two drops of water one can write hundreds of pages. Then what about a jug of water? How many pens can be created? How many inks can be created? And how many thousands of pages can be written with just one jug of water? Then what about a pond? What about a river? How many pens can be created? It is beyond our imagination. Then what about an ocean? Allahu Akbar. Who can guess how many pens can be created and how many inks can be made from one ocean? Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala did not stop here, that if you make use of all the trees of the earth as your pens, and if you make use of the ocean as your ink, and if you make use of another seven such oceans and start writing the tafsir of the Holy Quran, everything will be vanished. But you cannot complete the words of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, which is never ending, which is infinite. Allahu Akbar. How can there be an end when these are the words of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, who has got such knowledge to complete the tafsir of the Holy Quran? Subhanallah. Only one, and that is Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, who got the whole knowledge of the Holy Quran, because it is Allah who stated in Quran, Ar-Rahman Allama al-Quran. Oh my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are the one who taught you the Holy Quran, and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has stated, Wa allamaka ma lam takun ta'lam. Oh my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is we who taught you each and everything. Whatever you did not know, we have taught you all those things. Allah Ta'ala has stated in Quran, another verse of the Holy Quran, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has stated, Thumma inna alayna bayana. Oh my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran which we revealed, it is upon us to explain you the Holy Quran. We are the one who will teach you the Holy Quran. In other words, when a person cannot write the tafsir of the Holy Quran by making use of the whole ocean, seven oceans, making use of the whole trees of the earth as his pens, when he cannot complete the tafsir of the Holy Quran, in other words, he cannot complete the ilm of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by making use of all the trees of this earth, and by making use of seven oceans as inks, he still cannot complete the knowledge of Allah's Habib Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So how can one say you are praising Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much, up to that extent that you have taken him near Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, you have made him to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, ma'azallahi rabbil alameen. My dear brothers, when we are not aware what is the ending point of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we are not aware what is the starting point of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, how can we say that we have made our Nabi towards Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? My dear brothers, for those people to say you are praising Nabi in such a way that you have made him to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that means those people are aware, ma'azallah, what is the limit of Nabi? And where is the starting point of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? Is this sense, my dear brothers? Who is there to say this is the point where Allah ta'ala begins? Who is the one to say this is the point where is the ending of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? None can say this, because we are unable to comprehend. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala's Rasul sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam stated, do not praise me in such way, the way the Christians praised Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, by referring this hadith. They say, see, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said not to praise him in such a way, the way Isa alayhi salam was praised by the Christians. Allahu Akbar. These people are unable to understand the context of the hadith. What was meant by Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, these Christians, they said that Isa alayhi salam is son of Allah, do not praise me in such a way. Apart from this, praise whatever you want. You can praise as you want, but don't say that I am son of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. This is wrong. This is kufr. Subhanallah. So these people are misinterpreting the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anyway, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has stated in Quran, وَرَفَعَ بَعْدَهُمْ دَرَجَاتِ. We have exalted the status of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over all the other Rasuls of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala never mentioned, I have exalted my Habib with 1,000 ranks than Musa alayhi salam, or with 100,000 ranks than Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allah Ta'ala did not mention the limitation that this is the rank of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Allah Ta'ala stated, وَرَفَعَ بَعْضَهُمْ darajat. Allah has raised him darajat. How many daraja? We never know. So when we are unaware, Allah has not revealed for us to comprehend what is the ending point of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then how come one say that you are praising Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over the limit? There is no limit. So we can praise as we want, as stated by Sayyidina Imam Busiri radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Qasidatul Burda Sharif, دَعْمَدَّعَتْهُ النَّصَارَى فِي نَبِيِّهِمْ وَحْكُمْ بِمَا شِئْتَ مَدْحًا فِيهِ وَحْتَكِمِي. Don't say the way Christians used to say to Isa alayhi salam as son of Allah. Apart from this, praise your Nabi the way you want. Praise your Nabi in light of Quran. Praise your Nabi in light of hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anyhow, the thing which I wanted to mention here is, everyone is unable to understand the Holy Quran. The whole Quran was understood by Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And after Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, other prophets of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, after them, the Sahaba karam ridwanullahi alayhi majmain, then the Taba'in, Taba Taba'in, whomever Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala granted such knowledge and wisdom. Let me explain you in a few words. Subhanallah, Sayyiduna Imam Abdul Wahhab Sha'rani radiallahu ta'ala anhu has stated that his brother was such a great alim that he derived knowledges, not one or two, 247,999 knowledges from Suratul Fatiha. Sayyiduna Imam Abdul Wahhab Sha'rani states, my brother was given such a knowledge that he got the knowledge of 247,999 from Suratul Fatiha. Allahu Akbar. And Awliya Kiram, they got such knowledge. Subhanallah. It is stated in Fatawa Ar-Razawiya by Sayyidina Ala Hazrat Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, with all the references, that there are some Awliya who says that there are 1,000 knowledges which can be understood from each verse of the Holy Quran. 1,000 knowledges which can be understood from each verse of the Holy Quran. And there are more than 1,000 which we are unable to understand. 1,000 can be understood from the Quran, and there are more than 1,000 which we are unable to understand. We are not aware of those. Subhanallah. And also some Awliya Kiram, they have stated that from each letter of the Holy Quran, 400,000 meanings can be derived. Subhanallah. So Quran is an ocean. We are unable to understand the Holy Quran. And these things, we are referring to such Awliya Allah, who also followed one of the four Imams. Subhanallah. Can we deny the knowledge of Sayyiduna Imam Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala anhu? What a great scholar he was, about whose kitab, Ihya'ul Ulum, it is said by the ulama that if Ihya'ul Ulum is kept in a house, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will protect that house from fire. Such a barakah blessed book is Ihya'ul Ulum by Sayyiduna Imam Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Subhanallah. He was also a follower of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And those who say, we will accept hadith if it is from Bukhari, we will accept hadith if it is from Muslim, if it is from Tirmizi, if it is from Siha Sitta, my dear brothers, even Imam Bukhari used to follow Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Imam Muslim used to follow Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. Imam Tirmizi, he was a follower of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And as for these Wahhabi thoughts, the one who follows an Imam, he is an innovator, he is a bid'ati. That means Imam Bukhari is an innovator in your sight, Imam Muslim is a bid'ati in your sight, Imam Anasai, Imam Ibn Majah, Imam Abu Dawud, Imam Tirmizi, all are innovators. That means how can you believe on the hadith taken by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim and all of the Siha Sitta, when they are innovators in your sight, when they were followers of the Imam, according to you they were bid'atis? So you cannot take any hadith from one who is a bid'ah, who is a follower of bid'ah, who is an innovator. So it clearly means they are following only their own desires. My dear brothers, Imam Bukhari, it is narrated that he was a follower of Shafi'i. Imam Muslim, he was a follower of Shafi'i. Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti radiallahu ta'ala, who was given the knowledge as per the narrations, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala blessed him with such a memory, such knowledge, that he had by hearted 500,000 hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Yet he was a follower of Imam Shafi'i. Imam Taqiyuddin Subuki, the Mujaddid of Islam, the great revivalist of Islam, the one who wrote the kitab Shifa'us Siqam fi Ziyarati Khairil Anam, and he proved all those hadith related to visiting Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in Madinatul Munawwara with the intention of visiting solely Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Wahhabis of today, they say these hadiths are fabricated, but 600 or 700 or 800 centuries ago, Imam Taqiyuddin Subuki radiallahu ta'ala anhu has answered to all these objections. 800 years before, he has answered to all these objections, and he has narrated all those hadiths with all the narrators, with the references, and said these hadiths are not fabricated, not weak, but these hadiths are acceptable. He has proved it 700 or 800 years ago, and yet he was a follower of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyiduna Imam Nawawi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who wrote the Sharah of Sahih Muslim, he was also a follower of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and it is narrated in the incidents, in the stories of Sayyiduna Imam Nawawi radiallahu tabaraka wa ta'ala anhu, that when Imam Taqiyuddin Subki radiallahu ta'ala anhu left this world, a great muhaddis, Allahu Akbar, a great imam of his time, he was a mujaddid, follower of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When Imam Taqiyuddin Subki radiallahu ta'ala anhu left this world, Sayyiduna Imam Nawawi radiallahu ta'ala anhu got hold of his position to educate, to teach hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. At that time, Sayyiduna Imam Nawawi radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, I will kiss all those places where Sayyiduna Imam Taqiyuddin Subki has performed ibadah in order to gain barakah. Allahu Akbar. Imam Nawawi states that I will kiss all those places which was used for ibadah, for prayer by Imam Taqiyuddin Subki radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in order to gain barakah from such a great sheikh, such a great muhaddis, such a great faqih. Allahu Akbar. Now those people who say kissing the hands and feet of awliya, kissing the hands of pious people is shirk, is haram, why are you referring to the books of Imam Nawawi? Why are you referring to the tafsir of Imam Nawawi of Sahih Muslim? Because according to you, he has committed shirk. According to you, he has done haram. You have no rights to follow any kitabs of all those imam who followed Imam Shafi'i, who followed Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Malik radiallahu ta'ala. My dear brothers, these imams, subhanallah, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has stated, man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fiddin. It means, let me explain you in my words. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated in such way that when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants to do better with a person, wants to do good with a person, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala blesses him with the knowledge of fiqh. Knowledge of fiqh is granted to that person whom Allah ta'ala wills to do better, whom Allah ta'ala wants to do good, whom Allah ta'ala wants to make him his friend, a wali of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. He is being granted the knowledge of fiqh. My dear brothers, all these muhaddisin, all these mufassirin, by having greater status, by acquiring higher status, including Sayyiduna Ghawsul Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was a follower of Imam Shafi'i, is there any shortcoming in the knowledge of Sayyiduna Ghawsul Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu? If he say, I am a mujtahid, we will definitely accept, and he is a mujtahid, but yet he followed Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and at a stage he followed Sayyiduna Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu tabaraka wa ta'ala anhu, Sayyiduna Imam Khaja Mu'inuddin Chishti radiallahu ta'ala anhu. What a great alim he was, what a great wali he was, and he was Imamul Awliya. He also followed Sayyiduna Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyiduna Imam Bahauddin Naqshbandi, Sayyiduna Shahabuddin Suharwardi. All these great imams of tariqah, they all followed any one of the four imam, yet they were great awliyas, they were leaders of the awliya. They were aware they are friends of Allah, they were aware that there will be followers in millions for them, but still they made it a practice and they showed us that do not assume, do not take this imam as ordinary ones. These are such great imams that it is compulsory on us to follow any one of the four imams. When these awliya, such as Ghawsul Azam, such as Khaja Mu'inuddin, such as Bahauddin Naqshbandi, such as Shahabuddin Sohrawardi, when all these awliya, including Muhaddisin, Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Tirmizi, when they all followed any one of the four imams, then just imagine the status of the ilm of the four imams. Who can grab, who can understand the knowledge of Imam Abu Hanifa, who can understand the knowledge of Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal? Let me tell you one more thing. Last night I was reading a book of Sayyidina Ala Hazrat radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He has mentioned this with the references. Subhanallah. The one who has by hearted, who has the knowledge of 400,000 hadith, still he is not able to get the meaning, derive the meaning from the hadith. Maybe he has got 400,000 hadith in his memory, still he is not capable to derive the meaning from the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if such a person has got knowledge of 500,000 hadith, still he got something, but we cannot say with confirmity that he is able to derive the meaning from the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 400,000 hadith, 500,000 hadith, after having such knowledge, still when they are unable to derive the meaning from the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that too in Arabic language, and that too by understanding the Quran, by understanding the hadith, by understanding the narrators, their life history, subhanallah, even after everything, they were followers of an imam, they were unable to derive the meaning of the hadith. Then what about these so-called doctors and professors who says we can refer to the translation of Quran, we can refer to the translation of hadith, and this is the meaning of this hadith. Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu has stated, if you find a hadith which is, if you find my qawl which is against the hadith and Quran, then leave my qawl and follow the Quran and Sunnah. That person, these people say, Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu has stated, if you find my narration, my qawl against the Holy Quran and against the hadith, then leave my qawl, follow the Quran and Sunnah. So these so-called doctors and professors, they say we got everything in hadith, we have got everything in a small CD, in a pen drive, we can search for the hadith translation. Though they are unable to read the Quran properly, they are unable to read the hadith properly, but yet they say we have everything in a small CD, so we know which hadith is sahih, which hadith is da'if. So we are rejecting the qawl of Imam Abu Hanifa ma'azallah, we are rejecting the qawl of Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu ma'azallah. My dear brothers, Imam Abu Hanifa did say that, but not for us. He told that for the mujtahideen, those who got such a knowledge. Imam Shafi'i did explain that, but not for us. It was for one of his students named Sayyiduna Ibrahim radiallahu ta'ala anhu. These people, they have omitted the word Ibrahim. Imam Shafi'i said, oh Ibrahim, oh my student, you got a knowledge of ijtihad, you have been blessed with the knowledge of ijtihad. And a mujtahid is such a person who has complete command in Arabic language, who has complete command in the knowledge of Arabic, and also he knows which verse was revealed first, which verse was revealed later, which hadith was revealed first, which hadith was revealed later, and which hadith contradicts from which hadith, which ayah contradicts from which ayah. And if there is a contradiction in our sight with the hadith and the Quran, then which to follow? What about the narrator, history of the narrators, how the narrators were? There are plenty of narrators. In some hadith, 3 narrators, some hadith, 5 narrators, some hadith, 7 narrators. Yet these imam, these mujtahid should be aware of all the life history of all those narrators for them to consider whether this hadith is sahih, is it hasan, is it za'if, is it gharib. For them to tell this, they should have all those knowledge, and also they should have this knowledge. What about the verses of the Holy Quran? What are the meanings of this Holy Quran? In such way that a mujtahid, he used to write one hadith in 60 ways. If I take this meaning of this hadith in this way, what would be the meaning? If I take this hadith in that way, what would be the meaning? In 60 ways, they used to derive the meaning of the hadith. And we people, by just referring to the hadith of translation, just referring to the translation of Quran, we used to say, not we, alhamdulillah, we are the followers of Imam. Those so-called people, they used to say, we don't need to follow any Imam because we got everything in our hands. My dear brothers, they do not possess anything except ignorance, because they are unaware of the reality. My dear brothers, the door of the mujtahid is not closed yet, but it is very difficult to find a mujtahid with such a knowledge. Insha'Allah al-Aziz, Imam Mahdi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he will appear and he will have such a knowledge that he is able to derive the meaning from Quran and Hadith as a mujtahid. So I was referring, Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu told his student Ibrahim that, "Oh Ibrahim, oh my student, you have been given such a knowledge, but in your ijtihad, if you find any contradiction on my qawl, then you refer to the Quran and Hadith." And these people, they have omitted that word Ibrahim, and they take, Imam Shafi'i has said for all the people, Imam Abu Hanifa has said for all the people, we are unable to derive the meaning. When those muhaddis who had memorized 400,000 hadith, they are unable to derive the meaning of hadith, who are we to say this is the meaning of this hadith without the explanation of any of Imams? Subhanallah. My dear brothers, this is a lengthy subject, but let me tell you at end, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has stated in Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُسْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. The one who deviates from the majority of the Muslims, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will make him stay as he is, and Allah ta'ala will put him in Jahannam because he has gone out of the way from the path of majority of the Muslims. Today you see majority of the Muslims, they are the follower of four mazhab, including all the awliya, including all the muhaddisin, all the mufassirin, and also Sayyiduna Imam Tahtawi radiallahu ta'ala who has stated, Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah has been divided into four mazhab in this era, and anyone who deviates from any of these four mazhab, فَهُوَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْبِدْعَةِ, he is a person of bid'ah, one not, and he is the person of the hellfire. My dear brothers, my topic was today to say a few words about Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. What a great Imam he was. Alimul Quraysh, he was from the Quraysh tribe. He was from such a tribe which was linked with Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has stated, Alim of Quraysh, he will fill the whole earth with ilm. Subhanallah. There will be one alim from Quraysh who will fill the earth with knowledge, with ilm. And muhaddisin says that hadith is referred to Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu tabaraka wa ta'ala. Similarly, there are hadith for Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik as well. My dear brothers, Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala was such a pious person that at the age of 7, he completed the whole Holy Quran. He memorized the whole Holy Quran. At the age of 7, he became a Hafiz. And at the age of 12, as he was studying under Imam Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu also, at the age of 12, he has memorized the whole Muwatta Imam Malik, the hadith book written by Sayyiduna Imam Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He had already memorized before he reached the age of 12. Allahu Akbar. And at the age of 15, Sayyiduna Imam Malik and other great Imams gave the authority that Imam Shafi'i is a capable person and he is a mufti. He is able to give fatwa at the age of 15. At the age of 7, completion of the Holy Quran, memorizing the Holy Quran. At the age of 12, completing the hadith book written by Imam Malik, thousands of hadith in his memory. And he had already recited the hadith in front of Imam Malik. And Imam Malik was very much pleased when he saw this young boy is reciting by memory the whole hadith of mine, the whole hadith which I collected. Mu'atta Imam Malik, at the age of 15, he was granted such a certificate that he was able to give fatawa. Subhanallah. And my dear brothers, Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a very handsome person, and it is also narrated that his beard was full of hands, one fist. And it is also narrated that Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu was such a pious person that every day he used to recite the whole Quran. Every day he used to complete the whole Holy Quran, and during the month of Ramadan he used to complete the Holy Quran 60 times, that is two holy Quran each day, and he used to divide his sleeping time, his night, into three parts. Out of three parts, if there are 6 or 7 hours, he used to divide into three parts. One part for him to rest, other part to recite the holy Quran, and the third part to study the knowledge of Quran and hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers, Sayyiduna Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala anhu has stated that for last 30 years there was never such a day that I did not make dua for Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala. 30 years I am engaged in making dua for Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala. He was also a student, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he was also a student of Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala. And see the adab. Though they got, Imam Shafi'i got such a knowledge, such wisdom, such prominency, that when he said he saw a dream, Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu came in his dream, said salam, made musafaha, and Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave him a ring. When he inquired about this dream, he was told by his uncle, the meaning, the interpretation of this dream is, when Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave musafa to you, that means you are free from the azab. Subhanallah. When Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave you his ring, that means wherever the name of Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu is popular, your name also will be popular there. Sayyiduna Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu's name is all over the world. Similarly, the name of Imam Shafi'i you can find in all the parts of the world. See Sri Lanka, see India, see Pakistan, though majority of the followers of Hanafi Mazhab, yet there are Shafi'i followers. See the whole of Indonesia following Shafi'i Mazhab. See the whole of Egypt following Shafi'i Mazhab. My dear brothers, all these followers of all four Imams, they are spread all over the world. So though he got such a status in the sight of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he got such a prominency, yet see their humbleness. He says that we are children of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu in fiqh. Imam Abu Hanifa is the father of fiqh, and we all are children of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala. And he used to visit Sayyiduna Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Baghdad. He used to visit his Mazar Sharif, his shrine. And when he himself says, when I find some kind of difficulties, I used to go to Baghdad, I used to visit Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala, I used to pray 2 rakat nafil, and I used to ask dua by the wasila of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and my problem used to be solved by the barakah of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala. Who says one Imam, such an Imam who is followed by majority of the muhaddisin and mufassirin, such an Imam says that I used to seek wasila of Imam Abu Hanifa in the time of difficulties, and Allah ta'ala used to make those difficulties ease for me. And Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was such a great person that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he used to visit for his problems at the mazar of Sayyiduna Imam Shafi'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Though they were Imams, yet they respected each other. So my dear brothers, we have to follow the path of the majority of the Ahlus Sunnati wal, part of the majority of the Muslims. That means we have to follow the Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. We are not following Albani or Bin Baz or Bilal Philis or Dr. Zakir Naik or Abdul Rahim Green, those scholars who are just for the namesake. These people, they follow Bin Baz and Abdul Wahab Najdi as the Imam. The difference is, you follow the Imam of last century and we follow the Imam of the second century. You follow the Imam of this era and we follow the Imam who are followed by all the muhaddisin and mufassirin. So who is greater in status? You or us? Anyhow, though you say you don't follow any Imam, but yet you follow Abdullah ibn Baz, yet you follow Ibn Abdul Wahab Najdi, yet you follow Ibn Taymiyyah. But Alhamdulillah, we are following those Imam who were followed by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Sayyiduna Ghawsul Azam, Sayyiduna Khaja Mu'inuddin, and all the awliya Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So Alhamdulillah, we are on the right path, and as per the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ السَّبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُسْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ. The one who deviates from the path of the Muslims, Allah Ta'ala will let him remain in his path, and Allah Ta'ala will put him into Jahannam, which is a bad place. Alhamdulillah. And also Allah Ta'ala stated in Quran, in Surah Bani Israel, يَوْمَ نَدْعُوا كُلَّ أُنَاسٍ بِإِمَامِهِمْ. On the day of judgment, every person will be called with the name of his Imam. So the tafsir, one of the tafsir says, O people of Hanafi Mazhab, come this side. O people of Shafi'i Mazhab, come this side. O people of Hanbali Mazhab and Maliki Mazhab, you are granted success. You are granted salvation. This is one of the tafsir. يَوْمَ نَدْعُوا كُلَّ أُنَاسٍ بِإِمَامِهِمْ. On the day of judgment, every person will be called with the name of their Imam. So alhamdulillah, we are happy. We won't be called the follower of Ibn Taymiyyah or Ibn Abdul Wahhab, but we will be called as Hanafi, Shafi'i, Maliki and Hanbali. And these people, they used to say this also. Quran states, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, ati'u Allah wa ati'u al-rasul wa ulil amri minkum. For obey Allah and His Rasul and obey the Imams, the people of authority. فَإِنْ تَنَازَاتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. And they misinterpreted. Don't stop from this ayah. See the next part of this verse. These people, they used to say that Allah has stated, فَإِنْ تَنَازَاتُمْ. If you find any contradiction with this Imam, فَرُدُّهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. Then you again search in Quran and Hadith. My dear brothers, this is not for us. Allah Ta'ala stated this for those mujtahid who are capable to do this, who after deriving meanings from the Quran and Hadith, and yet if they find any difficulties, it is for those mujtahidin to refer to Quran and Hadith again, not for the common people. And this is the tafsir recorded, tafsir Kabir, tafsir even tafsir Sawi, and many other tafasir. This is what is mentioned, and these people are just, by referring to the translation of the Quran, they are trying to mislead the general public. So please be aware from these people. And also, before, already the time is past, I'm very sorry for that. We have no right to comment on any Imam that they did such a mistake. The way Zakir Naik says, Imam Abu Hanifa made a mistake in this place, Imam Shafi'i made a mistake in this place, we have no right. Sayyiduna Zakariya Al-Ansari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu writes, which is written in the book of Imam Abdul Wahhab Sharani. That means Imam Sharani says that Sayyiduna Zakariya Ansari, not this Zakariya of this era, we are referring to the Sayyiduna Zakariya radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was centuries before and recorded by Imam Abdul Wahhab Sharani, that Sayyiduna Zakariya Al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu states, you have no right to say any about, to comment about any qawl of Imam as a mistake unless you become a mujtahid. Unless you become an Imam, you have no right to comment on that. And also Ala Hazrat radiallahu anhu has stated, those great Imams such as Sahibul Hidayah, such as Sahibul Quduri, those great Imams who were 500, 600 years before, even those Imam, they have no rights to comment on any qawl, any statement of an Imam, let it be Imam Shafi'i or Imam Hanafi or Hanbali or Maliki. Even these great Imams, they have no right to comment that this is wrong and this is right. Allahu Akbar. When such great Imams, they have no rights to comment and say that Imams made a mistake, who the hell are we to say that Imams made a mistake? May Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala protect all of us. I am sorry for using harsh words. This is because today people are being misled by so-called scholars. So it is my duty and the duty of ulama to make you aware of these things, so that we and our children to be refrained from these people. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala forgive our sins, and may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala make all of us firm on the aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah, and may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala make us firm on following the Imams. And before I end, one announcement with the permission of the Trust Board. We did a conference, Aqeedah conference, in 4th of June. The DVD of that, which is ready now, which is available at the office and here for 350 rupees, two sets of DVD, along with a book named Ja al-Haq. The book which contains everything, majority parts of the Aqeedah, such as our Nabi possessed the knowledge of unseen, Ilmul Ghaib, he is present, celebrating Miladun Nabi, prophets are alive, prophets cannot commit sins, these things are proved from Quran and Hadith, that is 500, this DVD is 350, spend 850 rupees and protect your Iman. And I will say, buy extra one or two copies and give it to your friends, give it to your children, give it to your friends and families. If any one of them comes to the right path by referring to these books, this will be enough for your najat. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala bless all of us. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah.